This is the left side. This is the right side.
Welcome back to Pretty Good Vibrations. We are in part two of our top 20 Sherwood songs, our navel gazing that knows no end. Again, I will say, like I said last week, if you're not a Sherwood fan, you don't have to listen to this episode. I hereby absolve you of the responsibility, especially part two, if you're not. But if you are, or if you're curious, or you want to hear three old friends talk about, you see how we talk about this stuff 10, 15 years later, then welcome. 15 to 20 years later is more like it. Wow, crazy. I'm so glad to be joined again by Mike Leibovich, who I refer to as Mikey, and Joe Greenetz. Joe Greenetz is at least easily the most guested member on Pretty Good Vibrations at this point.
Yeah, the last few weeks, this is like my fourth recording, so I think that puts me in the lead.
Yeah. So I don't know what's going to come out when, but you and I did just wrap up a 90s alternative / alternative rock tournament, which was
you and I
fun.
Have one cooking. We have one
Mikey
cooking.
And I've got one cooking. Actually, a pretty cool idea. Joe, can we run this by you? Let's just get some live feedback from you here.
Sure, sure.
Okay. So Mikey's idea was to do that early, mid 2000s, like post-punk revival. You know, centered in New York City, The Strokes, Yeah Yeah Yeahs, LCD Sound System, all that stuff. And then my idea was to say, to actually break it up geographically. Mm. So pick like five bands from New York, the UK bands, and then maybe like the rest of the world, like three little kind of geographic things to sort of talk about those scenes.
That could be cool.
What do you think about that?
Yeah.
5-year period, 2001 to 2006. So many cool records came out in that time frame.
Yeah, that
I think it's
really
a great idea.
Fun. Yep.
I love the idea, Mike. That's going to be really fun. But we're not here to talk about very, very clearly and very visually celebrating.
I was pumping
fists there that you got, that your vote got, your idea got approval.
Something
that probably should have happened more often when we were in a band together, frankly. Probably more of your ideas should have been approved. We got through 10. We got halfway last time. And we are talking through, I'll just remind people, we're talking through our favorite songs collectively. We each put together basically a top 10, top 12, and then I put it all in a spreadsheet, gave higher ones more points, lower ones fewer points, and then turned that into a top 20. And rather than going from 20 to 1 or 1 to 20, we're going chronologically, and then the biggest songs we're doing at the end of each album, the ones that got the most votes. So we are smack in the middle of A Different Light. This is our 2007 sophomore full length, certainly our most popular, well-received album that we ever released, produced by Lou Giordano of Atari's, Taking Back Sunday, Goo Goo Dolls, Sunny Day Real Estate, Husker Du fame. And we had already talked about three songs, The Only Song, A Different Light, and For the Longest Time, as well as I'm Asking Her to Stay, where I played the summer EP version, but is also on this record. We got two left on A Different Light. And for each one, I like to see who had it highest and ask them to talk about it. And for this one, Joe had this the highest. This is Middle of the Night, track 3, I think, on A Different Light. And I remember writing it. Joe, do you have anything to say to set up Middle of the Night before we hear a clip?
It's hella fun to play on drums, I'll tell you that much.
What's fun about it?
Oh, it's just really fun, dancey beat, really tight. Has a nice variety of grooves in it.
Something you mentioned on a different song is little kind of Easter eggs is the wrong word, but little like melodic phrases or rhythmic things that we will kind of pepper through a song and then call back to them. And this one kind of at the end of the chorus, which I'll kind of try and play this little riff, it's Mikey's keyboard part, which I think is on Rhodes. That is basically the melody of the da-na-na-na-na-na guitar part, which is in the middle of the chorus, but it's slowed down to half speed.
I did not know that.
I mean, I I am realizing that now. My guess is that one of us had that idea and thought, let's see if we can slow that melody down and like put that as an interstitial piece. So I'll kind of start the clip there so you can hear what I'm talking about. So here's Middle of the Night from A Different Light. I mean, why would I want to? I left the scream in. I went long enough to get to the scream to tell the story that I was unable to replicate the scream. Do you remember this, Joe, in the studio?
Yeah.
And we asked Michael Rosas to send us the scream from the summer EP version.
And really, Tom Anderson kind of strong-armed us into being like, I love that scream and it needs to stay in.
Oh, I don't remember that part.
Yeah, he loved the scream. And I think we were fine to go without it. But he was in the studio and he was like, hey, let's do the scream.
We never did it live. We never did I don't really know. That's probably the best scream I have ever produced. And I'm glad because I can't do it. I don't even know how I did it. I don't know how to do it. Maybe I was like smoking cigarettes then or something like that. I don't know. Stupid idea.
This is a great song. And I feel a little bit like it wasn't in my top 10, but it probably should have been. Mm-hmm. I sent my top 10 to David. So David, for those who don't know, was our touring, guitar player and band member for from 2007 on. And he was like, dude, you're missing Middle of the Night. Like, that's got to be on there. He's like, that's one of my faves. So that's great. And I, for some reason, kept thinking we wrote this in Mexico, which is not true.
No, because it's on the EP. Yeah.
It's on the EP. There's something that I know you listen to a lot of Killers, Joe. I don't know how much of like drums were influenced for you in this song, but
I would love to take credit for the great drumming in the song, but it's like 99% Dan's composition.
I do think you did put a little somebody told me juice on the ball, listen to the drums in the chorus again. This is dangerous because I'm putting a Sherwood song up against just a massive radio
what
hit
could
from
go
the
wrong
same
here?
The exact same era, but listen to the drums on this and I think there's a little something there. Well, somebody told me you had a boyfriend who looked like a girlfriend that I had in February of last year. It's not confidential. I've got potential. And actually that, that's my version of, it's not as good, but it's trying to do the same thing poorly.
So Dan, I remember very specifically, we were driving somewhere late at night. On tour after a show, driving from one city to another. Yeah. And you were driving and I was either right behind you or in the passenger seat. And you were working on the song in your head and you said, hey, check out this chorus I wrote. I think this could be good for like an Ashley Simpson song or something like that.
I think I thought Britney Spears. I had no idea how difficult it was to get songs to such artists. This was very naive of me. But my first thought was, this is too poppy. Like, this doesn't sound like Sherwood.
Yeah.
This sounds like straight up.
And you sang
up
it to me and I just thought, that could be our song. Wouldn't it be nice if we had good songs?
and at first I couldn't see my way to it. It just felt like a top 40 dance pop song, but eventually I did. Then we probably got our instruments out and messed with it. And it was like, oh yeah, this totally works. And I think it was probably the first thing we wrote, with a kind of a dance drum beat, which was very much in the water. If you recall this time, I mean, Fall Out Boy was doing it with Dance Dance. Academy is an uncharitable view of the Academy is that they are a band because they timed that dance beat thing perfectly. And William is kind of a magnetic star of a guy. But you know, that was really going on then. And we did a bunch of that on this record. I mean, there's a lot of dance beat on A Different Light. A lot less, really, maybe this time on Q, a lot less there, but quite a bit on A Different Light.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a fun song. I'm pretty proud of it as just like a pop chorus. I don't like my vocals on it. I think I was putting too much mustard on the ball. But man, I'm just like airing out all my very specific regrets about each track. Should I stop doing it? Is it a bad look?
Could you just actually explain too much mustard on the like, ball? What is it?
Okay, here's the honest truth. I love our singer Nate's voice. He has an incredible natural set of vocal cords.
Yes.
I mean, on the record, this is to say nothing of the fact that they are made of literal bronze and they never break down live. I mean, he only missed one show vocally in 800 Sherwood shows, which is just absolutely unbelievable. But he kind of sings like with not a ton of not a ton of emotional inflection, like not a huge range, yeah. Right? He kind of
little he's meant no for vibrato, like a
loud
yeah,
he's meant yeah. for like a loud emo pop kind of pop punk kind of a band. He's totally got that thing. He's like a Will from Cartel kind of a thing. Like just sounds really good when he's kind of singing loud. And I do think later on he found more and more of that dynamic range. I think he did better on Q, and I think he did even better on Some Things Never Leave You, actually. I think that's some of his best vocals. But earlier on, I was trying to kind of like, well, he's going to sing it kind of straight, so I'm going to get real attitudinal and kind of sassy with it. And we're going to back and forth, you know, a lot of Taking Back Sunday, a lot of Reliant K listening. And I think it, you know, it's not like it ruins the song for me or anything, but I would approach it slightly different.
It doesn't bother me at all.
Okay. That's good to know. I'm glad.
You can,
which leads us
you can,
to.
You can mustard it seemed up like that a little. Ball.
Yeah, a little bit of mustard, but.
Okay, so the next song I actually have highest. It is our biggest song
your
of
number
all time.
One?
It's my number
your
two.
Number one?
My number one was For the Longest Time, which we already heard.
Yeah.
This is my number two, and it's Song in My Head.
My number four.
And it's Joe's number four-ish as well. Yeah, it's number four. So, obviously, if people know any Sherwood, they know this song. This is definitely our most popular song. This was on Tom from MySpace's profile for 24 hours and logged 700,000 streams.
Woo!
At one point when the album was coming out. This is actually, to me, the most interesting thing about Song in My Head, and it's maybe interesting to do it as setup rather than after we hear it. Interesting conversations later with our managers, the Chris's, Chris Donahue and Chris Bradstreet, who ended up managing us for many years together. When we put out Q, that is the time that MySpace Records was willing to put money down to try to get us on the radio. And they probably spent $100,000 or something like that. They hired the label hired a full-time radio promo person, Risa, who we became friends with, and we did, I mean, actually, I missed it, maybe because I was getting married or something, but you guys did a short acoustic tour of radio stations,
yep.
And I missed it. Kind of dodged a bullet there from what I heard. But
was
this
it just
is,
the four of us, Joe?
I think,
Nate?
Yeah, everybody else.
Joe,
right?
David.
Dave was there.
I think so.
Because Dave was singing, like, my parts and stuff, when applicable. So this song is the one in kind of retrospect that what Bradstreet told me once was like, what we should have done, and I don't know if anybody even thought to do it at the time, including us, who very much wanted to be on the radio, what we should have done was pushed them to do a campaign behind this song, which had like organic momentum behind it, and maybe might have been a better fit, you know, like get a Tom Lord Alge mix and throw it to the radio and see what happens kind of a thing. I think that would have been a better use of their funds than trying to do it on the next record when the label, because MySpace itself had so much less cachet. But we didn't, and that's fine. And we still have a song that I'm really proud of that I wrote in about 30 minutes one morning in Mexico. Came very quickly. It was ostensibly about my ex-girlfriend, but I always kind of think of it as like inspired by Jaffrey, who I had at that point been dating for just a couple months. So, love you, honey.
Even though it's a breakup song.
Even though it's a breakup song, but it was like it inspired it. Okay. It was like, you know, being with her. Okay, here's a song in my head.
Oh, I don't believe it, that I could be so deceiving and bringing you down to feel this lack of loyalty.
It's a very wordy chorus.
It's kind of wordy. Yeah. That, by the way, is a good example of what I'm talking about, though. Nate is like not like screaming, but he's at like 85% belt, and it's just like right in the pocket. He just was like born to sing like that. Sounds great.
Right there at the end when it goes into the bridge, that's kind of a rare time when we did some accidental notes on purpose, yeah, like, but yeah. out of key. And I think that we were talking last time about, you feel a lot of our early material is a little too sweet and lacks tension.
Yeah.
And I think that bridge does a great job of adding that. And that's maybe why a part of why it was successful.
Yeah. It's interesting. As we were listening to it,
do we need to pause?
I was like, I wonder what's,
you're good. Keep going.
I was like, I wonder what's in the internet archives about this song. And I found a review from punktastic.com.
Punktastic.com, known for their hard-hitting journalism.
Came out in 2007. Sherwood write cute summer pop songs that are catchy and inoffensive. And that formula has been evenly spread across their last three releases. As the old saying goes, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And you could easily apply this to Sherwood.
I don't think we ever called ourselves punk.
Just a second here. This is a bummer. It's a bummer, dude. Second Lebowski quote tonight, Joe, for you. For those who are keeping score at home. Old 2000s like web forum album reviews sound so much like they were written by ChatGPT today.
Totally.
I mean, I suppose that is essentially what ChatGPT is using to like do its
own
writing.
But isn't that a little bit now, like if you just kind of want to like nag someone's like writing quality, you just kind of go like, was that written by ChatGPT?
No, I know. Obviously, of course, that wouldn't have been true then, but yeah, I mean, inoffensive, that's pretty accurate for most of it. Unless you are the Christian store distributors, in which case Hell of a Time is quite offensive and would disqualify you from being carried in their stores, which MySpace tried to get that record in Christian bookstores because of the Reliant K.
There is a story. Like there is a story I'm hoping to jog in your memories. We made a music video for Song in My Head.
Nate made a fantastic music video for it.
Yeah. And we filmed it in Yuba City, right, Joe?
Yep, my hometown.
Yeah.
Your hometown. And somebody else had a similar like themed music video. Who was it?
I just spoke to this person and I am now blanking.
It's Jim Septic from the Get Up Kids.
It was Jim from the Get Up Kids. Just met him at the Motion City All-American Reject show a few months ago. Yeah, and he was like, oh, you guys are the ones who did a better version of the music video than we did or whatever.
Then his side project, Blackpool Lights.
That's right, Blackpool Lights video, not Get Up Kids video. Yeah. Nate made many quite good music videos, I will say. I will give him credit for that. Mm-hmm. Well, so that's a different light. You know, could that song, let me just ask you guys this with your kind of memory of the time. Do you think that could have been on the radio with like Check Yes Juliet by We the Kings and Boys Like Girls, Great Escape and whatever Cartel got on the radio and... Like, do you think that might have worked? How far would it have gone?
It could have had some moderate success. I think it might have required like a radio edit because the intro is very long.
You know what I was thinking the other
you
day?
You had a radio
I
edit,
wish
didn't
we,
you?
I wish we cut I the we intro did. On the album. I wish the album just started with Nate going, I wish it just went straight in. I think it would have been a much better. That intro sucks. Like, I hate it. I always skip it.
Yeah, but it's an album intro, right? Like, that was
sure.
Part.
But like that's aged poorly, I think. Like, just get to the song. It's a I really like the basic composition of it.
How do you think the guitar production came out on that song?
You know, we could talk about the album as a whole. I guess we should because we're wrapping up a different light. My one kind of production note on this album is that the guitars are a little quiet. And that's kind of a Lou thing. It's a lot of drums and vocals down the middle, pumped pretty loud. If you listen to that second Taking Back Sunday record, it sounds like that too. And I, you know, it's just, it sounds really clean and clear. It certainly served us to have a recording like that, especially as we were trying to make new fans from all these, you know, opening for all these bands. Yep. One thing we haven't talked about is in 2007, when this album came out, we did three straight full U.S. tours, spring, summer, fall. We did Reliant K, Motion City Soundtrack, The Academy Is. Joe, you probably know, but we must have played something like 140 shows that year.
And then the day after The Academy Is tour ended, we flew to England and did 3 weeks there.
That's right.
That was two also or three the weeks. End of 2007?
It was literally the next day, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. My memory is that all of that stuff was in 08, but... We were so young and full of energy back then. I was just like, fuck yeah, let's do that. Let's go.
Yeah, it was a very fun time, but thinking about it now is exhausting.
Yeah, yes, it is. It is exhausting. You know, we talked about favorite record and favorite sounding records. The next two records are definitely my favorite sounding ones, but A Different Light is now my favorite album.
I think for what it is, being a big rock album, It succeeds on that front, like huge choruses, right? Like,
yeah, I think a handful of them.
The production pretty well matches the ambition and the direction that we were going.
There's something, I mean, we talked a little bit about, so we had done Warped Tour in 04 and 06. This album came out in 07.
Yeah.
And that it just feels like it was a very, like we just had a very singular focus on, I think it was like an album we wanted to blow up at like a Warped Tour and the bands we wanted to tour with. And I think the songs are great. And there's just a consistency in the production of like that. This is where we want to be. This is the moment.
Yeah.
That, you know, in Q, we kind of, I think, tried to harness just what is interesting to us and explore different routes. And there's far less maybe like continuity throughout it. So I think for that, it's a great record.
Aw, that's okay. Still a great doctor. All right, next up.
And I mean, while you were writing the whole album, Dan, I had so much fun on the beach in Mexico. Let me just tell you.
Well, I was writing with Joe as my trusty squire, basically like engineer. And not just engineer, I would say I would bounce everything off of you. And Joe, you were working on like some programming stuff and you had a lot of ideas for arrangements. It was that I have such fond memories of that. It is a bummer, Mikey, that you and Nate were not more involved, like that I didn't know how to do that basically. But Joe, I have such fun memories of just like basically waking up every day with no hangover from the Johnny Walker Red Label we drank the night before because we were 23 and just fucking going to work every morning. Well, looking out at the ocean.
Here's this, the two of you, honestly, kind of, I mean, you both, you just put in so many hours. It's like, I just remember all day you were sitting at the computer demoing out, you know, arranging, demoing all these yeah. songs. Joe's there kind of like doing editing, engineer work. Yeah. Yeah, editing all of this. And then you would decompress by going and playing Zelda, where Dan, you would be playing and Joe would be like...
No, Nate was playing
Nate,
Zelda.
No, Nate was playing Zelda. I would be there Nate with the game guide Zelda. Walking him through it. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Joe, you had a very like consistent role throughout that time in Mexico.
It was very fun.
Dan yeah. and Nate's little helper for two very different tasks. That's not accurate for what you were helping me with. But okay, so by the way, I forgot to say, middle of the night, overall number two ranked song of the three of ours, song in my head, overall number one. So even though it was highest on mine combined, it had the best score. So moving on, after a different light, we did all that touring. Then in 2008, we toured mostly abroad. I think we did one headliner where we had the Matches as main support on half and Houston Calls as main support on the second half. The Higher were out with us. And who was the opener on that tour? Do you guys remember?
The Pink Spiders.
No, Pink Spiders is later, I think.
Oh, later.
Different tour. Anyway, we might have had locals or maybe there was someone else opening.
Waking Ashland?
I don't think so.
No, they
it might have been We Shot
that.
The Moon, actually. It
might have been We Shot the Moon. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, they might have been First of Four. Jonathan's second band that Joe and I were involved in. But then we rented an apartment in Oakland for about 8 months and wrote Q, the third record. And in the middle of that, I wrote this kind of holiday winter song when I was visiting Jaffrey in Seattle and it was snowing up here. My wife is from here. That's why I live here now. And we actually engineered it ourselves. Joe, you engineered this song, and I think we probably mixed it together. And then the engineer, Jamie, who had worked on A Different Light, who worked at Motor Studios in San Francisco, he mastered it. We went a little too hard on the de-esser for the nerds, but pretty decent mix. And this is a fun song. It was like a free download holiday thing. Here's Snowing in Seattle.
It's colder than December.
So, Joe, you wanted to hear a little bit of the outro. Should we play that before we talk about it?
Yeah, even closer to the end there. Yep.
Okay. There's just a kind of this chaotic, mashup thing going here.
Was that just, did you just run all that through reverse delay, that outro? Like, did you run the drums through reverse delay?
The outro, no. So it's like, it's guitar, the reverse guitar, I don't know if that was actually reverse, like we just recorded it and then flipped it around, or there was a reverse effect. The drum, the clicking you hear.
I thought it was
is
delay.
Like,
it's like a reverse delay.
Maybe. Dan could weigh in on that. But the, like the clicking and clacking is like, we were listening to a lot of Bon Iver. And the first album, and kind of like a lot of sounds of the cabin where he recorded that. And we had this rehearsal space in our apartment in Oakland, California. And we were like, let's explore the space. And we just got sticks and clanged on things around the studio space. And I can tell, the influences I hear from that song are very clear to me, which is Not a Surf, which I have always been a huge fan of.
I was just
going to
say Not a Surf.
Yeah. Not a Surf. A bit of Tegan and Sarah in there, I remember, and some Bon Iver, although that's a little bit of a stretch for us to try to pull off, so we kind of threw it in there at the end.
I mean, there was something else that you were really busy doing while we were recording that song, Joe. Do you remember?
I feel like you're getting
at
something.
You had a job.
Oh no! Oh no!
I don't remember.
You got it. You have to tell listeners, Joe.
Oh,
you didn't actually make any money
from
the job.
Gotcha.
So for those who don't know Joe, first of all, Joe will win Jeopardy and Trivia Night hands down over anybody who's ever with him. So Joe gets hired by this fledgling startup tech called Cha Cha, and this is 2008.
Cha Cha might be the most 2008. Thing that you could mention from 2008.
So, smartphones were out, but people weren't really accessing Google on their phones yet.
Internet didn't really work yet.
Internet really wasn't a mainstay of mobile devices. So people, there was a startup called Cha Cha who, what they would do is people would text them a question, and then experts such as myself would get those questions, look them up on the internet, and text the answers back to them.
You were ChatGPT before ChatGPT, Joe.
I just can't believe that existed.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. I never got paid
it. What did they tell you they would pay you for?
You had to like accumulate a certain minimum threshold before they would cash you out. And I didn't have like the time and energy to really pursue it full time. And, you know, when you break down the hourly rate, it was quite pitiful. I just enjoyed doing it.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to talk about the Not a Surf thing briefly. So it's come to my attention literally in the last like 3 or 4 months that Sherwood really was a power pop band. I used to say emo pop. I think I would now say emo power pop, emo / power pop. That's what we were. And like a power pop revival band, much like Not a Surf or Super Drag or, you know, what have you, especially those kind of more guitar heavy ones. And I think Snowing in Seattle is almost like a path that we could have plausibly taken if we weren't wanting to be so experimental on cue. Like that is like not that far away from A Different Light, but it is distinct. It's a bit more indie. But it's like that song as a composition, like as a power pop little package, honestly holds up pretty well. I kind of wish we had a better recording of it because the sibilance and the vocals bothers me when I listen back to it. But that one was, I was kind of pleasantly surprised listening back.
We thought about re-recording it during the Q sessions, but I think the impetus wasn't there and we just didn't have time. Going back to Oakland. So after we did A Different Light and did a just marathon year and a half of touring, we kind of said, okay, we spent a month in Mexico writing this. Really focusing, spending that little period. What if we just now had like 6 months of doing nothing but working on songs? Like, you know, if you get a million monkeys with typewriters, like something great is going to come out of it eventually. And let's give this our best shot. Like if this isn't going to work, then we might not ever be able to get bigger as a band.
It's funny. We were essentially right about that. I think it was the right thing to do. We took our time. If we had rushed the record, it would have been bad. And we made something that I'm really proud of, but that also demonstrated that our band had a kind of a ceiling, I think. And if we hadn't been so diligent and spent so much time, I think I would have been less confident that that really was a ceiling, maybe. And then we might have tried again. And maybe then we learn that there's this, you know, so it's like kind of interesting to do the what if.
I look back on that time and I more think like we put that record out and then our label folded and there was a massive recession. I mean, it's not that different of like a sophomore slump album, like something we're proud of. Right. But it was like
you're talking about Q.
Yeah. I mean, I think Dan's conclusion is like the album sort of helped, maybe we recognized there was a ceiling, but maybe not. Like, I think if...
No, I think that's plausible too, Mike, yeah.
Of things that were happening, I think, in our lives and the environment, yeah, it were different than maybe we would have been like, okay, you know, different label or whatever, but...
Yeah.
I'm proud of the record.
I am too.
Me too. I really am. And so let's get to Q now. So of the four songs from Q that made the list, by the way, Joe, you were the only one who had Snowing in Seattle on your list. I'm glad you put it on there. That was fun to listen to that and talk about.
I had
about
one on here you just didn't put, which I just think didn't score high enough.
Yeah. There's a fifth that got cut off from Q. So we're going to hear four. The first one we're going to hear is You Are. And this one's interesting because we had done 10 or so songs and we had, you know, we had some other demos that were always kind of like on the edge, are these going to get made or not? And Tom came and listened to the whole record with us and was like, you know, I'm sorry to be this like record label guy. This is Tom Anderson, the president of MySpace.com. He's like, but I don't think there's a single here. I don't hear a song that we will push, you know, to radio and other ways from these songs. And, you know, that always stings a little bit when you hear that, especially when you fancy yourself, as I did and do, a pop songwriter. That's like literally the kind of songs I write. They're pop songs. And you're just telling me I didn't write you a single. So they had us do some co-writes. And honestly, that was a really fun experience that it was challenging in some ways that, I don't know, if you guys have questions about it, I can answer them. But it's an interesting process. And we did get, oh, buddy, hold on. Fuck me. Okay. It's like just, guys, it is like this. This rate, most hours he's awake, it is this rate. He is cries for 1 to 4 minutes every 25 minutes. And it's like anytime he has to digest or shit or fart, it makes him
pain. Can't hear
well,
him very much.
Maybe, yeah, he's pretty far from the mic, but yeah. It does. Once I compress it, like it kind of, I can tell later it gets in there because I've had him with me for a few of these during, after he was born. Okay. So You Are, which is the song we're about to hear. This is the one that they're like, okay, you did it. That's the single. And we made a video with Matt Wignall. We can talk about that afterwards. This song, I think the verse doesn't totally work for me, but I really like the chorus a lot. And I still really enjoy this song.
If I'm right, you'll find every piece will fit together just the way.
Power pop. That's why I like it.
It's a fun song.
Really fun.
Yeah.
It's straight up power pop, except for the kind of slightly dancey stuff going on in the verse, which was very much of the time. Who had this highest? Let's see. I didn't have it on mine, but I kind of think I should have. Mikey, you had it slightly highest at number 7. You want to say anything about it?
Yeah. I mean, it's a really fun. It's a fun song as a keyboard player too, like the synth part, a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And I remember, well, there's a couple memories actually I have of this. So we made the music video with Matt Wignall. It's a really silly but fun idea of basically we're all getting carried away with balloons and then I get really carried away and everyone's coming in and chasing me. I don't know why, but we were on Cal Poly's campus. Maybe we had come back, I think, as we started to tour on this song. And I'm walking through the University Union, and there's like You know, MTV by that point had like 16 channels of MTV, so I don't know which version of that was.
Yeah.
But that music video was playing on
probably MTV, was on MTVU or something like that.
Yeah. And it was like, yes.
That's cool, though.
Such a cool feeling.
That.
Yeah.
Plus, you're the star of the video. I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah, a little bit. But it was fun.
We should mention the insane happenstance. Nate's idea for the video was to actually try and do like a deep fake, like a stage, essentially a public event. Where it was supposed to get picked up as a real piece of news that a person had floated away from balloons. He was going to try and get that. And then like it would turn out, it was like a PR idea. Oh, is this band? And it's the video for this great song. And he thought it would like, I mean, it's a very typical Nate idea that like, for all you know, could actually work. And then what was it?
The Balloon Boy in Colorado.
Balloon Boy
later.
In Colorado was a week after we filmed the video or something like that, where there was a kid who actually went up in a balloon for a while and he was okay, right?
I think so. But yeah, like we saw the news and Nate was just like mouth agape, like, what?
I can't believe that happened. That chorus, I like it. I'm very, very proud of that. That needs to be in my top 10. I hereby amend it to put it somewhere up there. Thank you guys for putting it on yours.
So
Anything else to say?
We recorded that song after we had finished the sessions for the rest of the album.
Yeah.
And so it was kind of crunch time because like the album was coming out and we needed to get this song really done. So I think Brad Wood, who produced the album, he kind of like took the reins a little more and was like, okay, just let me do my thing to get this song put out. And it turned out really great sounding.
Yeah, I'm curious, Dan. To me, the verse is the least Sherwood verse of probably any of our songs.
I was listening to like Phoenix, I think, at that point. Mm. And that was trying to like Phoenix and Spoon. So this big, like super compressed, almost like you're playing acoustic guitar chords on a sampler kind of a thing.
Yep.
And, you know, that was just in the water at that time. And it's a kind of a cool idea. The verse melody is, I don't know.
No, it's kind of
lazy.
It's cool. It was more like, I think it was.
I didn't play that more, acoustic verse. I played the second verse, which was more like, dance pop, whatever.
You really put the mustard on the ball on that one.
Okay. All right. I'll find some new analogies. Yeah. But yeah, that one's fun. And then I love Nate's woo as it goes into the, I mean, that kind of stuff. Oh, can we play the end, actually? I think this is a really good example of something that I always liked about our band. I think we were pretty good with bridges and little instrumental things peppered throughout. Like Joe, you were talking about last time in part one, from the very beginning, spending all those hours in the illegally built practice space in our garage. Illegal in many ways. And then when we got with Brad, Lou had a few ideas for arrangements and stuff, and he would maybe, you know, add one layer or something. But Brad was really hands-on, especially with like bridges and final choruses. And he was like, that there should always be something surprising there if you can make it work. And the ending here of You Are is like a really good example of like how he helped us kind of finish songs. And I think this record on the whole has like really creative bridges and final choruses. And a lot of that was either Brad's ideas or Brad directly pushing us on that. So let's get an example.
That was That was my attempt to have a Third Eye Blind sounding drum ending.
You succeeded.
Thank you.
And that was apparently my attempt to have a Fountains of Wayne ending to a song. And we both succeeded. So That's great.
You mean like where the melody drops out and it's just the harmonies singing?
Well, that part which we heard, and then also the very end, like kind of just ending it in this sort of 60s pop kind of a way, and, you know, slight variation on that final line. And I don't know, it just feels like, just feels very power pop to me. Next up from Q, a song I'm very fond of. This might have been on all three of our lists. This is number 5 overall. Make It Through. Let's see who had it. Mikey and I both had it, not Joe. So Joe, you will have to answer for why you didn't include this song after we hear a clip of Make It Through.
Oh, leave the roads on every mile into a cord that wraps you up and pulls you back.
Joe is holding up photos from the background vocals session on that song. And there's a photo.
No, this is the claps and stomps session.
Oh, the stomps and claps. That's right. So those stomps and claps are actually us. We recorded them in the studio.
In our house next door.
Oh, that's why. To save time, Brad gave us, or we had some of our own recording equipment, and we recorded our own stomps and claps. And then he threw them in his like sampler and stuff like that so that we could not waste studio time on it. But like, and three girlfriends were there at the time. All three are now wives. Beth, Mikey's wife, Beth, my wife, Jaffrey, and David's wife, Sarah, were all there in the studio that day. So there's also photos of all of us singing the whoa-ohs, which is like real big sounding. I have some more thoughts, but I want to hear you guys first.
This song started out as kind of a big minor key rock song. I remember working on it while we were in the UK, and it morphed from that into something else.
I don't remember that at all. Interesting.
So here were my notes as I think I put this number 5. First of all, it's only a 2 minute and 55 second song.
Yeah.
There's no bridge. There's really no fluff. I mean, it's a solid verse, solid pre-chorus, solid chorus.
Tight little power pop song.
And even, has it been 15 years since?
So it's been, almost 15 years.
I'm still a sucker for like gang vocal choruses. Like it's just, I love it. It's great. It's ear candy. That's what I wrote.
We were obsessed with the idea of getting like a big license, like a big sync in a movie or an advertisement, which is so funny because, of course, I went on to do that for a full-time living for 12 years. We did not succeed. But Brad had worked with Ben Lee, who had a couple big like commercials for some of his songs. And we were like this. We were instrumentally aiming this straight for, an iPod ad or something, we hoped. And that is kind of silly now. I think that some of that is a little bit annoying, but it doesn't really detract. Like, it still works, but I like it especially just as a songwriting composition. I'm just pretty proud of that pre-chorus especially. Sometimes,
this might be a tangent, Dan. I just
a
emailed
major
you.
In the final one? Oh, sorry, Joe.
Go ahead, Mikey.
I was just going to say in that... That jump to A major in the, I think, final pre-chorus.
At the end, yeah. Yeah, it's a...
Very Beatles.
Very Beatles. It's like maybe a little on the nose.
Yeah, I like it. Dan, I just emailed you that first draft of this song that was the big rock one. I don't know if you're able to pull that up.
I should be able to play it, yeah.
Joe, you really should have stuck with cha-cha. You don't forget a thing.
We're not going to hear any more of that. Wow. Obviously, we figured something better out with that one. Interesting, Joe. Thanks for finding that.
Yeah.
So just to, Dan, didn't you have a hard drive with like a ton of demos that you lost at some point on tour?
Okay. I think I might have told this story before. I don't mind telling it again.
It. It's a great story.
No. The answer is there's not like a bunch of lost demos. But what Mike is just trying to get me to talk about is that I decided early on in the band's career, like maybe like right towards my third year of college and we started touring, that I was not going to pirate music and movies and stuff like that. Like that was really, really big then. Like all the file, like the P2P file sharing apps were huge. This was like the era of Napster and like torrents had just started and you could get movies and stuff. And I was like, you know what? I'm literally trying to make my living selling music and playing music. I'm going to sort of practice what I preach and I'm not going to do that. I felt like it was wrong. And then like, I don't know, at some point towards the end of our touring years, like 6 or 7 years later, I guess, I slackened a little bit on those ethics. And I did have like, I don't know, 15 or 30 movies or something and some albums that I didn't want to pay for because we didn't make any money really. And I lost this hard drive and I looked everywhere for it. I looked everywhere. I tore the RV apart and I couldn't find it. And I was like, guys, I don't totally believe this, but some part of me thinks genuinely that like God took my hard drive to teach me a moral lesson about slacking on my pirating of media. Now, to be clear, I never even more than 50% believe that that's what happened, but I could not think of an explanation. I was like, I literally looked everywhere. But then, Joe, what happened?
Nate found it in it slipped between the cushions of the passenger seat of the RV.
No, it was like the back of the driver's seat or something. It was a weird spot. Like it wasn't like obviously just stuck between the cushions of the couch.
Let's sure. Not, it, yeah. It slipped down.
Let's
into
not
the
make it sound.
Back
it was
the,
a yeah. weird, it got in this weird cranny and he found it. And I was like, of course it wasn't a message from God. A message from God.
Okay, so I remember that wrong. You thought I was making a joke. I remember you losing the hard drive, but I thought you actually had demos on it. I didn't realize that part.
I mean, there might have been some easily replicable ones probably. I mean, yeah. I would have had, yeah. I had a little voice memo thing too and stuff. So, okay, two more from Q. Fan favorite and ranked number 4 overall for us. By the way, Make It Through was number 5. This is Ground Beneath My Feet from Q.
If I close my eyes, I hear the gates swing wide. And by the morning light, I will have seen both sides.
For this one, I wanted to play a little bit of that, you know, just so people could hear one of Mikey's kind of brighter recorded moments in the band's history, playing that beautiful grand piano next door.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. And I mean, unlike most of our other songs, which were some type of MIDI, right? Like this was one that Brad was like, you just got to get a full take of it. Like, we'll just keep going. Dan, is there any chance you can fast forward? So one of my notes, I have the drum fill in the second half of the final chorus. Super tasty drum fill, Joe. Yeah. I love the drums on this song.
Yeah, this is super fun to play the drums on this song. This is like one of our more sprawling, epic rock numbers. It was fun to explore this kind of idea and like make it real big and see what we could do with this format.
I think it's certainly the loudest we ever got until The Unknown on the 2016 record. Maybe similarly loud. You guys can hear Stellan a little bit in the background here. Okay, I'll play that that last part, Mikey.
Every second takes 1,000 days away from me. If I close my eyes, I hear the gates swing wide. By the morning light, I will have seen both sides. So why'd you let me go? I can no longer see, and I can't breathe.
I love that fuzz bass. The fuzz bass is real nice.
Joe, I don't think I've ever told you this, but I have so many fond memories of us arranging songs together. Mm-hmm. And when it came to your drum fills, you were so, I mean, those were so fun. Like, there were times where you would be like, I got this fill. And there were other times where you were really open to just exploring it. There were times where just like you and Dan were jamming. And what was amazing too is because you have an incredible memory is you would play a fill and then you'd be like, we'd be like, dude, that's great. And you'd be like, well, actually that's on Jimmy Eat World's second album, eighth song. Like you just like your ability to memorize drum parts. But this song has some great drum fills.
Yeah, I mean, this one is super fun to play.
Yeah.
This is another song that also went through like five iterations before we landed on this. And I think, you know, the slow piano version in the beginning, and then we decided, oh, let's make it a big rock thing. And we ended up just using a hybrid of all these previous demos. And that's what ended up being, that's why it feels, I don't think it feels disjointed, but it's certainly like a suite. It has different movements to it.
Yeah.
Okay, I've got a bottle for my son here, and we're going to keep going.
So speaking about the drums, Sherwood was really fun because we had three pretty competent drummers in the band. And that made it so there was a like, you know, three heads are better than one. So
you, then David, then me in order of ability.
I would say that your composition was stronger than mine, but in terms of...
couldn't play for shit compared to
you. But that doesn't matter.
Not contesting that. You're not. No,
I'm not contesting that.
I know. No, it's true. But no, I write decent drum parts. We're a good team.
Yeah, and so especially on cue, that was very collaborative. We got to just really think through a lot of different things, and we all contributed ideas to the drums, and it turned out really fun.
Yeah, I mean the place that we rented had a soundproof rehearsal room inside like the apartment. And when we weren't being productive writing songs, we were trying to avoid getting shot or having our car stripped for parts. Mm-hmm.
It's possible that one of us wanted our car to be stripped for parts.
Yeah, it's
without naming names.
Not me though.
No,
I didn't know.
It was a rough neighborhood, rough-ish neighborhood in Oakland, and
with some incredible Mexican food. Oh,
just Mecca,
the best.
Honestly, it was. I have such great memories of living there and working on this. Joe, you're totally right to talk about the collaboration. This song, also speaking of collaboration, Nate wrote most of these lyrics, and that was the first time he had done that. He contributed significantly more on cue than anything before that. And then on Some Things Never Leave You, I don't know, maybe 50-50 with me or something like that. Lots of very collaborative on all the lyrics. And, he's a good lyricist. He's a fucking good lyricist. And this song, I think, kind of is maybe the first proof of that. But also some of the lines he wrote on Make It Through, I know are really cool. Like, I think the weaving the roads on every map into a cord that wraps you up. I think that was Nate's line. That's a really cool line. And so this song, you know, it started off as like, I probably had some, I look around and see the ground beneath my feet. And then I was like, I have no idea what that means. You know, I had the melody and stuff. And Nate's like, I think it's about a soldier going into D-Day. And I was like, all right, run with it. And like, I think he pulled it off.
Mm-hmm.
Go off, King.
Joe, do you remember like what you were listening to in heavy rotation during the making of this album?
During the making of Q, let's see. We were listening to a lot of Bon Iver, the third Killers album, Day and Age.
Yeah.
Are We Human? That song was a big influence on us.
Yep.
Weezer's Red album came out. I remember Dan bought it on vinyl. We had that in our apartment. A lot of LCD Sound System.
Yeah.
Sounds of Silver, I think.
Yeah, I just took Around You off of the list for mine as I re-listened to everything because it doesn't hold up quite as well as a song. It's a vibe, and it was my favorite Sherwood song for a really long time. I think in a kind of egotistical way of like, look what we could pull off. We could pull off this indie dance thing. And I think we pulled it off, but it, as I listen back, it's not like one of the best Sherwood songs, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, Arcade Fire was pretty big back then.
Yeah.
Yep. Neon Bible was out. Yep.
Yep.
Mikey, what were you listening to?
Arcade Fire was, I was going to say that if you didn't, LCD Sound System.
Tegan and Sarah, I think, was pretty heavy in our rotation.
Yep.
Let's hear our final song from Q. This is Maybe This Time. And Joe, like you were saying earlier, this is another track that had many versions of it. Took us a while to end on the final version, which does have a lot of killers in it, as you were mentioning. But I'm pretty proud of this as a piece of songwriting. I like this one. Here's Maybe This Time.
Oh, wait. Kings of Leon. That was another huge thing we were listening to in 2008.
Tons Only by of the Kings night. Of Leon. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. But now here's Maybe This Time. See someone hearing that and just thinking, guys, that's just like bargain killers. But I like the chorus.
Yeah,
a good
hit. Chorus.
It hits.
It works.
Was this the only song we had Glockenspiel on?
Make It Through had Glockenspiel.
Okay, because we were talking about earlier. We were talking about that radio tour, and that's what I think that's what I brought.
That's right.
That was the instrument.
That's so 2008.
On 2009, the acoustic radio tour. Yeah.
That's so 2009. That's like very Feist and all that stuff. Let's talk about Maybe This Time and Q in general.
It's a really great sounding album. I'm very proud of it. It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun to both write and record. To write it, we lived in Oakland for 8 months, and then we moved down to beautiful Los Angeles and lived in an incredible home next door to the studio. And that was just a ton of fun.
Valley Village, California.
I think in terms of an album, I mean, there's so much instrument diversity. That was fun. Other than the natural piano, though, we never talked about this. I wasn't super stoked on many of the like synth production. Hmm. I mean, I feel like, but that kind of ends up happening. Like you have these MIDI parts, and it's usually the thing you save till the very, very end, only because it's the thing that doesn't need to be done in the studio. And so I just didn't feel like we spent a ton of time exploring. Like, I mean, it's fine. Like that synth wall kind of, you know, like big chord wall in that chorus, mm-hmm. I think does a nice job. But yeah, I just remember
very much feels 2008, 2009 to me though.
Oh yeah.
That's like, I was listening to Editors and like these British bands and the Killers. And it was that kind of synth pop is back on the radio with radio rock thing. And yeah. And you know, I don't think any of us knew how to get those sounds really. And so it was like piecing together presets, or maybe Brad knows something or whatever. And it makes sense to me that you would not be as stoked on those sounds. Yeah.
Well, they were just mostly software, right? Like we weren't exploring a bunch of like analog synth stuff. And again, it was just like, but that piano actually that happened to be in the house we were renting, not part of his studio.
Yeah.
Because the person we were renting it from was a music therapist. And so we were like in the therapy room with the like baby grand piano that the therapist used.
No, we had a baby grand in the house, but then in that separate music room, there was a beautiful full grand piano. And
Separate music room was where the person did their therapy. Right. Yeah, there was one in the house.
And
yeah.
She let us use that for some recording. Yeah.
Yeah.
Joe, will you tell the story? Tell the story of how you do the pattern against user drum fill when we did it live and how it's not on the record. And then I'll play the drum fill real quick.
There's a very... I wouldn't say it's very famous. There's a really great drum fill, but from the band at the drive-in that you, me, and David were all big fans of. And when we played this song live, we were able to sneak it in as a little Easter egg for the 1% of fans who might also like us and at the drive-in.
Not a lot of overlap. Here's that drum fill.
That's it. Hello.
And then David and I would yell, hey, like we were in at the drive-in, which we were not.
Just a little treat for ourselves.
Sometimes it's nice to get you got to get yourself something nice and sweet. Anything else to say about Q?
I don't think so. I mean, what can we say that hasn't already been said, you know?
I mean, inquiring minds want to know how we landed on that album name.
We had a hard time coming up with a name, and Dan, it was ultimately your idea, and we were like, yeah, great.
It kind of meant nothing, and that was part of it. Like, we literally could not agree on a name. We were so deadlocked. So just having basically a MacGuffin that means whatever you want it to mean. It worked out, I guess. It's a weird name. Oh, well. A lot of people called it QU, as you would imagine them to do that, because that is the way it's spelled. We got to talk now about one more album of ours. And Mikey, you are not a part of this project, so we don't expect you to have a whole ton to say. But, you know, feel free to share anything you want about it. I would be curious. I don't know if you've listened to it. We haven't really talked about that much.
I listened to it. I'll get it out now. I think it's one of my favorite sounding albums.
Production-wise. I agree.
In fact, I think your drums on this record, Joe, are my favorite of
any record.
They sound
really nice. And I can't believe that, because Brad, who did the drums on Q, I mean, Brad is known for his drums. He's one of the reasons we wanted to work with him. I love them. But this room at Stone Gossard's place in Seattle.
Yeah, so, okay, we broke up for a few years. We decided to make another album. Dan, how did you get to know the producer, Luke Vanderpool? Luke Vanderpool.
Well, we first met...
listeners, that's funny because I was just like waiting for Stellan to stop crying and Mikey decided to answer as me. We met just through like a bunch of mutual friends in Seattle, basically. And I think at that point I'd worked on some very simple like demo recordings, like live studio recordings for my band Pacific Gold at the time. And, you know, we were buddies. So he had done the Deep Sea Diver first record, History Speaks. Which sounds incredible. He engineered the second one, Secrets, whichever one it was, Secrets, I think. They did the first one with Wignall, a great indie rock band from Seattle, friends of mine. And so I was like, dude, he's a great engineer. And so I asked him, I was like, would you want to work on this? Because we're doing a Kickstarter, Indiegogo, whatever. And he was like, hell yeah. So we basically made our own album producer out of hiring him to record it and then hiring Matt Goldman to mix it, who also makes records.
Yeah.
And that ended up being a pretty great combination.
Yeah. Luke is a young guy, kind of didn't have a reputation for himself at the time, but was very talented and knew where to go to record things. So to do the drums, we rented a studio owned by the guitar player from Pearl Jam. And it was kind of a Candyland for me going there, and like a lot of my favorite grunge albums growing up were recorded in this studio. And so to get to record drums there was an incredible treat for me, and the drums ended up sounding really great. So getting great drum sounds requires like a well-tuned kit played by a good player in a nice sounding room with good equipment
tuned
well and engineered by a competent person. It takes a lot of things to make it happen. And Luke really knocked it out of the park.
So we've got three songs from Some Things Never Leave You. The first is our number 20 overall. It's called Bottle It Up.
I like that song. It's our more Blink-182 leaning material.
It is kind of instrumentally quite Blink-182, but then vocally and lyrically and very much not. It's this kind of nostalgic, kind of softer glaze on it. So that's kind of an interesting combo. I like that song. I still listen to it. It's on my playlists and stuff. I think we found something that, you know, we do pretty well as a band, and it came together for me. Mikey, is this one of the songs you like on this record?
Yeah, I mean, the listeners can't see the three that you've selected, but I think they're all strong. I'm curious what, as you thought about album order, so this is number six, right? It's kind of what led you to that placement?
Putting it six or seven, it's six on the record. I think that we knew, like, back home, track five is kind of long and
we were thinking about the album in terms of, like record sides.
Yeah.
So this was a good way to open up side B.
Yep.
Yeah, that's a concise way of saying it. Okay, we got two more. We're going to go a little quicker here on this album. The next one is called The Unknown, and this is fucking insane. This is literally the most he has ever cried for me since he was born, I think. I really think so. Buddy, tough night. I don't know. Are you sick? Are we maybe a little bit sick? We got some really bad toots. We got some really bad toots. Okay, so the next we're going to hear is called The Unknown. It's the final track on Some Things Never Leave You. And this is one of my favorite Sherwood songs. This one came in overall at number 14 between the three of us.
What was that on your top 10 or top 13?
I had it number 6 and Joe had it. Joe didn't have it. I'm the only one who had it, I think. So I guess I'll just talk about it myself after we hear a clip. That is the main part of the song. I think we have to play at least some section where it's very loud to hear how loud this gets.
No, does it.
I like that one.
It's a great song.
So, question for you. It's a really great song. It has brand new vibes to me a little bit. And just in general, nods to like just early 2000s kind of emo. It's a good song. I like how it builds. So, Dan has to end the episode a little bit more abruptly than we would have loved to, because he's taking care of Stellan here, and Stellan just needs a little extra love. So we just can't tell if Stellan's, you know, outside or in, or maybe outside in, you know. But that's our final song here, folks. We appreciate the journey you've been on with us.
Track 12 overall. First track on Some Things Never Leave You.
And the best part of this song is the end, where it goes to like the quarter time.
Yeah.
Super fun to rock out.
We're just
going to
play that part. We'll find a nice part towards the end. Thank you guys for listening. This is going to play us out. Stellan is having a tough night. So thanks for listening.